and duality is like a central part of optimization. Most difficult for many people, but I hope that I explained in a relatively easy way. Okay, we'll start with this and maybe then discuss if you have questions on previous stuff. So if I have a function of two groups of variables, two vectors, then zeta and omega, and I minimize it in Z, for each omega I get some value, so it's function of omega, minimum in Z, this is function of omega, and this would be smaller if I would not minimize. You can remember about this first minimum. This minimum make right-hand side smaller than left-hand side, and despite that we continue maximize and so on, this is stronger than others. So max min is smaller than min max. Okay, and we say that this is very tightly related to some setting of game theory. So if I have two players and as a result of their choice, that player will pay to omega player this amount. So then that player will try to minimize this amount and omega player will try to maximize, and their strategy will depend on who is playing first and who is playing second. If somebody is playing second, it's very easy. Say it's omega, it's not W, it's omega. So if omega plays second, he already knows what is Z, so it just maximizes. For first player, the situation is more challenging. He should anticipate the other player. And here it's some introductory lecture on game theory a couple of days ago. And they say that the central point of any game is anticipation of your partner in the game. So you should anticipate. So if Z player plays first, he anticipates that omega player will maximize for each given Z. So Z player will try to minimize all possibilities, all future possibilities, the worst future possibilities of omega player. And in this type of game, it's better to play second, because you already know what happens. So if that player plays first, he will pay more than if he plays second. And that's why we come to the same relation, which we had by general considerations in the first year. Okay. Any question? Any comment at this point? This is completely new stuff, and in my experience, one should get used to it. It's not easy. It's not easy from the beginning. So it will be useful if any of you will be able to ask something meaningful. If not, we will move to examples and solve them in the class, and then the things may become more clear. Well, where do I have my examples? Let me see. Here. assume that the condition of my game, payment in my game, is given in the table. Say that player will choose a column of a matrix 1, 2, or 3, and the omega player will choose the row. So this is the decision space of Z player, and this is decision space of omega player. And here I will put numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay. So if Z player will choose, say, and omega is also omega. 3 columns, 1, 2, 3, and this is goes in this direction. So if Z player will choose some column and omega player will choose some row, the payment will be this the number here. And let's try to compute explicitly what will be minimum in Z, maximum in omega, F of Z omega, and vice versa, maximum in omega, minimum in Z. I may even pay parentheses to make easy understanding what is written here. And let's think, what does it mean, maximum in omega, what is in this table? If Z is given, if Z is given, say Z player choose the first column, what will be the maximum? I will put here. I will put here maximum and minimum. What will be maximum in omega if Z chooses first column? It will be 7, yes? It will be this number. And in this way I can fill this row of what it will be maximum of omega given Z. And after I fill this column, I can say what will be Z, that this maximum will be minimum. Of those three numbers, I will choose the minimum one. And this will be my solution, which I will put here. And vice versa. What I propose you, I give you really, I hope, rather clear idea what you should do with this matrix in order to compute those two values. I ask you to compute the values of those two expressions for this game, for this matrix. Okay, just write down on your paper and try to do it and who solves first will show us. Okay, question.
No, I think I'm done. Is it 7 and 3?
If you did it, it's great. Okay. Let's see a few more hands. Rhythm.
So
this column will give you maximum in omega. Yes. Given that, what will be maximum in omega? It will be here. Yes, in this row. In this column, I would put minimum in Z. Of Z omega. Given omega. For every given omega, I can put minimum in Z. Here, for every given Z, I will put maximum in omega. After you fill this row and this column, I hope you will understand what is the answer to my question. What is min max and what is man mix of this game for this given table. Okay, and if you did it again, please raise your hand. Okay, very good, and you were first, so please.
Maximum omega, so if this column is chosen, then the maximum is 7, and here it's 8, here should be 9. And if we choose from this row the minimum, it's 1, 4, and 7. And yeah, here we should put the
let me split in this way. So here we will put minimum of those numbers, and here maximum of those numbers.
So the minimum of 7, 8, 9 is 7, and here it's the maximum is 7, so they are equal.
Okay.
Which means f is a convex function and KKT conditions.
It's not because of convexity.
Oh, we have okay. A settle point.
Thank you very much. Yes, we will come to the next slide. Now we will come to the next slide because it's a very nice example. It shows us the meaning of the next slide. So if we have a saddle point, what does it mean saddle point? Such pair Z star and omega star that in Z, when we fix omega in Z, this is minimizer. If we go away from Z star, we choose any other Z, we increase function. And in omega, it's maximizer. So if we go away from omega star fixing Z star, we reduce our function. And let me finish. And let's look on this matrix. So we got to the conclusion that this is solution. We get 7 from here and 7 from here. Yes? Min max is equal to max here. And let's see whether this is a saddle point of our problem. Whether this is a saddle point of our problem. So if I change Z, I will increase. Yes? Let's see. Z is in this direction, in horizontal direction. If I move from this point in horizontal direction, I only will increase the part. It's in the corner, but it's not important. It could be in the middle. Again, it would be a saddle point. And if I go in omega, I will decrease. In omega, I have kind of maximum. This is the case. So if I go away in omega, this is given as reduction. The easiest continuous example of a function which has Saddle point, when omega and zeta are scalars, and you'll see it in the lecture, if I have z square f equals z square minus omega square. So 0, 0 in this case is also a saddle point. It's a maximizer in z and minimizer in omega. Okay, now questions about this. Yes.
What is the definition of a saddle point when we have higher dimensions?
When we have?
Higher dimensions.
So, pay attention that z and omega are vectors. So, for any other omega, so it's this condition should be satisfied. Okay.
How do we find the saddle point?
How do we find it? You did it? So you can do it numerically. You're asking very important question. If I have continuous function, what is numerical algorithm to find saddle point? This is a rather challenging area of numerical optimization. Sometimes you just solve for optimality conditions. If your function is convex in z and concave in omega, for example, especially if it's quadratic function, yes? You equate it gradient to zero and you get immediately to the saddle point. But for non-quadratic functions, it's challenging. And this is whole area of optimization, which we unfortunately don't so touch in our course, how directly to solve saddle point problems. Maybe I will have some hints in the end of the course. I should think.
So how can I determine if there is a saddle point in my function?
It's challenging. The opposite may be, if you find a point and you see that, for example, the Hessian in one variable is positive definite, so it's minimum in one variable, and the Hessian in other variable or vector variables negative definite, then you are in saddle point. Or you can check, you just do perturbation, arbitrary perturbation, and see whether this condition is satisfied. Okay. I would propose to do one more example with the matrix, with other matrix, and then we will go to conclusions and maybe have more discussions. So, my other matrix will be. Where's my eraser?
Over there.
It's here. Okay. The other matrix will be. Challenge to find the min max and max min. It's almost straightforward. Just try the question we have done. The next volunteer, almost immediately.
same as here, just that we will, in the end we will find that we don't get the same numbers down here.
Yes.
So if we take the maximum of the columns, we get 5, 5, 8, and 11. And if we take the minimum of the rows, we get 3, 4, and 5. So
3. The first is 3.
Yeah, it's a 3. Yeah.
Okay.
But the last one is 1.
3, 2, 1. I overlooked the 1. Sorry.
And
it doesn't really matter,
but
still. Yeah, it's
like good. Please, make it clean because we are recording.
Yeah. It doesn't change the solution, however. Okay, so to one. And now, as we did it before, we took the maximum of this, so we now take the minimum of this group, so we get 5 here, and we took the maximum. Now take the maximum of this, which results in 3. So
okay.
This time we get 2 different solutions.
Yes.
So we don't have saddle point.
Thank you very much. And let's circle the values, where the values are located. This one and 3 is here. Yes. And okay, we can check any of them. So it should be, when we move in Z, it should increase. But we see that there are points where it's smaller. Here in Z it really increases, yes, from 3. But in Omega it doesn't. It doesn't. And doesn't decrease, should decrease in Omega. So this is not saddle point and this is not saddle point. Yes.
So if we check this inequality, we can say that we have a saddle point, but can we say, can we go the other way around when these two numbers are not the same? Can we say we don't have a saddle point? Goes it in both directions or just in one?
Yeah, you mean after we solved min max and max min and see that they are not equal, then of course, because this is this if and only if. It should be actually. So if they are not, if there would be saddle point, they should be equivalent. If they are not equivalent, there are no saddle point.
But provided we have 2 saddle points in our function, what would happen then?
Like in the minimization, you may have flat minimum, for example. Forget about saddle point. Just I'm talking about minimization. I can have flat minimum, but the value is the same for all minima. So the and Pay attention. Greater or equal, you are allowed to have one more than one Z or more than one Omega when they are the same. And still the result of the theorem, min max will equal to max min, and it will be achieved in any of those points. The value will be the same, min max. Okay. Let's continue. And then we have, you see that it has great consequences not only in game theory but in minimization, in optimization theory. So if we have Lagrangian, and which is written here for problem with inequality constraints, you can easily show that maximum in lambda of Lagrangian is ideal penalty aggregate for our problem. It's infinity for infeasible points. Why? Because for infeasible points, sum of g may be positive, yet our constraint g less or equal to 0. maybe positive and corresponding number that we can put very large as we want. So it may go to infinity. And for feasible, the maximum which this term can give us is zero. We cannot go higher than zero, but zero can be always achieved with lambda equal to zero. So if this term is zero, then f of x. So it's very nice thing. So we have this ideal penalty aggregate maximum of Lagrangian. Then when we minimize it, we get to solution of our problem. We already learned we have ideal penalty. Minimize this give us solid solution. But just a second, let me finish with this slide. But this is like theoretical consideration. It's not practical numerical way to get solution. Because you cannot minimize it with Newton method. For example, this kind of function. I want to finish till end of the slide and we will discuss. Then we ask, what if we will go in other order? What if we'll swap between min and max? And what is written here on the right hand side? And define min minimum of Lagrangian in x as eta of lambda for every given lambda we have some value of minimum. So this is function of lambda, and we can try to maximize it in lambda and get solution. The only thing we know for Lagrangian as we build it. When we have inequality constraints, the Lagrangian multiplier should be non-negative. So maximum with lambda greater or equal to zero. So this function we will call dual function, and the problem of maximization we will call dual problem, and by properties and min max greater or equal to max min, we get that solving dual problem, we get something from below, something which is less or equal than our actual objective function. But in very many cases, this minimum is tight. So Lagrangian really have saddle point that min max is equal to max. Now, yes, question.
I can see it by the definition of the Lagrangian that the constraints are less or equal to zero. So basically,
yes,
if I get x that is not feasible,
yes,
then the penalty would be actually in my favor. It will help me minimize the Lagrangian. And it's the reverse of what I want from a penalty function. So why, instead of doing all of that, I just replace the plus sigma lambda igi with a minus, then I turn the penalty into positive, which is an actual penalty function, and then I don't need to maximize anything. I do just one minimization and I'm finished.
I think in the literature the sign is a minus and not a plus.
Are you sure that you're right?
Obviously
so
not.
This is my problem. My constraint in feasible area, g should be negative. And this expression penalizes, actually, somehow penalizes positive g. For positive g, it's larger than for negative. Somehow penalizes violation of constraints.
But the penalizer doesn't add to the function value, it reduces it. And when I try to minimize something, I want the value to be as small as possible. So basically, I get a reward for not being in the feasible area.
No. Your feasible area is when gi is negative, so if you're unfeasible, gi is positive, so you put some value into your Lagrangian.
Oh.
And only if you are in the feasible area, then you will then you will decrease the Lagrangian. But we choose the lambda in such a way that the decreasing is near to zero, because we choose a function which is flat.
But again, this is not yet numerical way to obtain solution. This is only way to transform the problem. The hope is that this minimum quite often may be computed analytically. And then, instead of solving our original problem, we will solve maximization of dual function. And we will go to example, and we will see it. I hope that we will have enough time today even to start some other exercise. Yes, we are blessing.
I have one more question.
Would you like me to get back?
Oh, this one is okay. Also, because in min-max theory, we have also min over x, max over, or yes, min over z, and max over w,
yes,
or omega. And here we have maximum over lambda, but lambda is not free, it has to be positive. So
it's restricted.
Yeah, so
actually, it's a good question. Thank you. Thank you very much. Let me open one new window. And I saved in my writings, but as you see, at least at this, so the general statement is that Z and Omega has its feasible sets. For example, here Z is from 1 to 3, and Z may be positive, or Z may be... So the statement is very general. If we minimizing over a given set of Z and maximizing over a given set of Omega, then the statements of minimax and saddle point theorems are valid. Yes.
Is there a necessity that the Lagrangian, if I minimize it overall, means I minimize for x and lambda together, I get the same solution as maximizing lambda and minimizing x, or vice versa? Because as we've seen in the previous lectures, when I want to get optimal solution for constraint optimization, I want to minimize the Lagrangian.
Again, numerical minimization of Lagrangian is in relatively rare cases the way to obtain numerical solution of constraint optimization problem. Usually you do a penalty function method or augmented Lagrangian.
The minimum point of the Lagrangian is equal to the minimum over x and maximum over lambda?
Try to understand your question. If I do maximum over lambda
and then minimum
over x, we show that this gives us really solution of the problem.
The optimal point.
The only thing we typically are not able to do it numerically, because maximum over lambda will give you this very strange.
Why is that true? Because f star is
true. Why is this statement is true?
Yeah, why it gives me the optimal solution?
Because this statement is true. Maximum over lambda is a function. If I have a function of two groups of variables and maximizing one of them, I remain with other variable. For every x, I have this maximum over lambda. And this is a very nice function. Maximum over lambda is ideal penalty aggregate for my problem.
Now I get it.
Then, if I minimize it in x, you have a lot of new stuff in this, so it's okay to... It's even very good to ask more questions. Okay. And... what we have else in our lecture? So what we proved, it's called weak duality. If we maximize the dual function, we get something less or equal to optimal value. But in two important cases, first of all, if Karosh contactor conditions are satisfied, then Lagrangian has saddle point, but this is shown in the lecture. And other even more general condition is Slater condition, which we just show, we don't show the proof, but it's much easier verifiable. So everything for convex optimization, of course. So if my problem is convex, I mean convex objective function and convex constraints, and for nonlinear constraints, I have a strictly feasible point. I have a point where all my inequality constraints are strictly satisfied for nonlinear. For linear constraints, it may be satisfied with equality. There is no such requirement. Then the strong duality holds. And this is a very important condition. And then I have example in the lecture of dual problem, but you know we have few minutes. Let's do it by hand. Let's do it by ourselves. I even don't show the corresponding slide. It's very good exercise. It's really, we will get used to the notion. So assume that we have a problem of minimizing half x transpose x subject to, for example, I have such a wide matrix A. I even will show geometrical AX equal B. So I assume I have underdetermined system of equations and want, so it has infinitely many solutions, and want to find solution with minimal second norm. Interestingly, building dual problem and solving it, we can easily get to known formula what is minimal is minimal norm solution of this problem, and I would propose you to start with Lagrangian L of X, I don't know Y or lambda, let's use Y. Should get used to different letters. So it's an objective function. I even will write it for you because it's straightforward. Plus Y transpose. You know it's will be more convenient to write minus. It doesn't matter for equality constraints. The Lagrange multipliers have no restriction on sign. So I can always write or minus or plus, depend on what is. Y transpose multiplied by my constraints. And my constraints is AX minus B. Yes, this is my equality constraint. AX minus B equal to B. Okay, let's minimize. Let's minimize it in X. Mean write down gradient with respect to x, equate it to zero and substitute, and find finally expression of minimum in x of Lagrangian, and this will give us a dual function. I just will go. Yes, dual function is minimum in x of Lagrangian. And then we will try to maximize this dual function. So this is dual function. we will try to maximize this dual function. The only thing important, and you should remember it also for the exam, when you have equality constraints, you have no restrictions on the sign of Lagrange multipliers. They may be positive and they may be negative, so no restriction lambda. Okay, start working, please. Yes.
Why is it not in a rush time?
Sorry? If I have equality constraint, I have two ways to act. I really may substitute this with two inequality constraints, or I may directly write Lagrangian for equality constraints. And it's often much easier. It's often much easier. Actually, you don't need any KKT conditions. What we want, pay attention what is written here. We want minimize Lagrangian in X. How do we minimize? And in X, actually, this is convex function. Because this is convex quadratic function and this is linear function. We just write down the gradient and equate it to zero.
Yes, and then we get A times X is equal to A transpose Y.
Okay, you have expression for X, and you substitute it here, and then you get only function of Y.
Oh, okay, yes.
But my goal, here is lambda, and on the whiteboard is Y, to get function where X is eliminated. Have only function of y, and my solution will be maximization of this function. So again, I will equate its gradient to zero. So if somebody got dual function expression for dual function, have you already been here?
For the matrix.
If today you were here, let's leave for other students. Check on the plan is good. If not, take the. It's good.
In order for us to find the dual function, we need to first minimize in X the Lagrangian, so we will write its gradient, which is X minus A minus 4, Y.
Okay,
we want to minimize it, so we equal to zero.
Yes.
And solution, which we will denote as a x star, is x transpose y.
Let's denote it as x bar, because x star will be our final solution. It's a intermediate, yes.
So our dual function, which is eta of y, is equal to the
please use other pen or press stronger because we are close.
We will use the solution of x bar and put it in the equation.
can simplify it, yes?
Yes.
Because you have two similar terms. It's very similar to what we have in the video. But it's good to return it by hand. Yes. Maybe it's minus here?
No, it's plus.
You just opened pi. Okay, thank you very much. So this is our expression for the dual problem. Okay, is it seen on the? So this is our expression for the dual function, and now we want to maximize it. Again, it's a concave function. The dual function is concave. You see, we have a minus in front of quadratic term. Without minus, it would be convex. So we just equate, we again write down its gradient and equate it to zero and find the optimal optimal Lagrange multipliers. And who will do it, please raise your hand and we will continue. This corner. I hope it will be enough space so that we don't have everything on one board.
Well, I can do it in steps, so you can see right away that if I calculate the gradient of this expression, I need one time to do the differential, I need one time to put the d on this side and one time on this side, and because it's a scalar, I can just take the transpose of it and I get the same expression. So I can right away get rid of this half and write that I get minus y transpose, a transpose a dy. And the same goes for this part. Because it's a scalar, I can take its transpose and I get plus b transpose dy. And so the gradient is, I take the transpose of that, and this is a minus a transpose a y plus b. And now I equate it to zero, and I get that...
Assume that a transpose a is invertible.
Yes. I get minus a transpose a y was minus b, we get rid of the minuses, and y equal to a transpose a inverse b.
Okay, very good. This is solution for dual problem.
Yes.
And
I plug it in the expression for
yes.
So I get x star equals to a transpose a minus
a transpose multiplied.
A transpose multiplied by a transpose I minus a hat b, and that is the pseudo inverse.
The only thing I'm afraid
I'm thinking
that
it
should
a
be a transpose.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, even earlier.
Yeah. It doesn't look like it. It's a ground position.
You're in the beginning. In the beginning. Why do I know? Because I have wide matrix and multiplied by something to inverse to have meaning.
A transpose is equal to A transpose A.
No!
So, not necessarily.
No, yeah. If I have... please have a look. If I have a product of those two matrices, it will be large matrix. And if I have product of those two matrices, it will be small matrix. So they cannot be equal to one another. So
this only applies to symmetric matrices.
Just put transposes into right way to have right record. A transpose in our video. Okay, thank you very much. So we have, and this is very, very known formula for pseudo-inverse, of A. So we obtained it knowing duality in optimization.
Where do we plug the Y in? Do we plug it into the dual function or into the Lagrangian? Or
plug it in here.
Okay, we got optimal Y. One can even say that it's Y star. And we say that so it's like maximizer, yes? We have maximum in Y L of XY. Just a second. We have maximum in Y, minimum in X, L of XY. So we say that this is Y star, yes? When we did everything. So we should substitute Y star here and minimize in X and get our minimax solution. Exactly what we did. Okay, what do we have this time? Okay, time is over. So as usually, if you want to stay and have free conversation, we will continue. And did you stop the video?